So in the morning session, we have discussed about uninformed search. And in particular, we have talked about depth first search, breadth first search, and the uniform cost search. Now, while considering those different search algorithms, there are certain notions how to find out the node which has to be expanded. And accordingly, I have already mentioned that there is a fringe or frontier of nodes, rather unexpanded nodes, which has to be expanded in next round. And depending on the algorithm that you select, the nodes are expanded accordingly. In case of depth first search, the algorithm scans the node depthwise. And on the other hand, for breadth first search, the algorithm scans the node breadthwise. And on the other hand, in case of uniform cost search, which is also known as the steepest first algorithm, so depending upon the total cost, the corresponding node is selected for expansion. Now, however, for each of these uninformed search, as we have discussed last time, there was no such guidance received from the environment. The algorithm itself does the searching process based upon the rule base which have been implemented inside the algorithm. So neither breadth first search or depth first search or this uniform cost search, none of them have considered the present situation as obtained from the environment. So during the process of search, the idea is to be smart about what paths to try. So there are several paths. We know, for example, if I consider, okay, let me consider that particular diagram once again. For example, if I consider DFS, so we'll be going in this way, depthwise, and then we have to search whether the goal test has been achieved or not. And for breadth first search, we have to scan in that way. However, there is no such guidance received from the environment. And that is sometimes essential in order to make your search algorithm smart enough. Because as I've already mentioned many a times in this particular course, that as we're talking about the artificial intelligence, so there is a constant endeavor to improve the intelligence within the algorithm itself. So as a matter of fact, one can say that the mechanism to expand those nodes have to be smart enough. So while you go for expanding any node, the path that you select must be a guided path. There should have been some guidance received from some information, some experience from the environment. And this is the fundamental idea behind the informed search. That means in case of uninformed search, if I go back to this 8 puzzle problem, so we have got one initial state comprising of 5, 4, 1, 2, blank, 7, and 9, 3, 4, or something like that. And from that, we have to find out the goal state. So one starting state has been given to you, and you have to find out the goal state. So you don't have any idea which path to follow. Only you know is that, okay, I am having, this is the starting state, and I'm having these four operators at my hand, left, right, I mean, moving the blank left, right, up and down. And accordingly, I do a random kind of searching unless I find out the goal state. And once I find out the goal state, I just provide the corresponding path as an output. So the idea in informed search is to provide some guidance during the search mechanism. So let me write it down first, the idea behind the informed search. That means some information is being provided to the system itself so that the search process can be made smart enough. And here the idea is a node is selected for expansion. based upon an evaluation function. Or based upon evaluation function, sometimes it is also known as a cost function. Evaluation function, I should write, that estimates the cost to the goal. Cost to goal. For example, if I start with a particular node A, and if I have several other nodes like this, B, C, D, and so on. So I have to pick that particular node which is closest to the goal. So for the time being, let us assume that there is only one goal in the search space, only one goal is there, although there is a possibility that more than one goal exists in the search space. So to make our discussion simple, let us assume that there is only one goal. So even if A can produce three different child nodes like B, C, and D, then which one has to be expanded further? So all of them, B, C, and D, they will be there in the fringe or frontier. But now we need to maintain a particular priority. Out of these three, or even there could have been more than that. So the number of nodes which are there, number of states which are there in the fringe or frontier, that particular node is selected for further expansion, which is closer to the goal. Because we have to find out the corresponding cost to the goal, and that cost will serve as an evaluation function. So accordingly, so if I consider the evaluation function to be like fn, so for every node n, the evaluation function fn is associated with. For every node n, if I consider that n is the variable for the node, so for every node like B, C, and D, the corresponding value of F has to be calculated. For B, I need to calculate what is FB. For C, I need to calculate what is FC. And for D, I have to calculate what is FD. Evaluation function. And this evaluation function gives you the estimated cost to the goal. So I can write this evaluation function as estimated cost. To the goal. Assuming that single goal is there, so estimated cost to the goal will give you the evaluation function. So accordingly, we should have an estimate of desirability. So if there are, say, three nodes are there, like B, C, and D, so they are arranged in decreasing order of desirability. So I have to consider FB, FC, FD. So this FB will tell us about what could have been the estimated cost to the goal. So if I reach B, what additional cost should I pay to reach to the goal? That is all about FB. What is FC? Suppose somehow I have reached C, then what additional cost or what additional cost I need to pay to reach to the goal from the node C. And similarly, FD satisfies the estimated cost that one has to pay to reach to the goal from the node D. And obviously, as an intelligent search method, our idea will be to explore that particular node for which the estimated cost to the goal is minimum. That we require always to minimize the cost. This particular, this type of algorithms, this type of search algorithms, this informed search algorithm will give you some guidance in selecting the next node which has to be expanded. And that notion which I am talking about is known as best first search. So already we have talked about depth first search, depth first search, and uniform cost search. Now this is known to be a best first search. So you need to find out an evaluation function which will tell us what should be the estimated cost to the goal, and we have to expand that particular unexpanded node which is most desirable. That means for which the F value is the minimum, because F value will give us the information about the estimated cost. So that might not be true always. We will look into this issue. That this is all about an estimation. Even if I follow that path, it is not guaranteed that if I follow a path for which the F function is minimum, it is guaranteed to provide me the best solution, or it is guaranteed to allow me to reach to the goal. Sometimes it can confuse me as well. So we will take a particular example to demonstrate this particular idea that best first search is also having some limitation. But to start with the notion of informed search, this best first search will give us some estimation about which path to follow. Suppose you would like to move from this planet to say North Kolkata. So as you know, planet is located at the central Kolkata, and if you move to the North Kolkata, then obviously you have to avail some vehicle which is not bound vehicle. So that is your basic intuition. You are in the middle, central Kolkata, you would look to go for a city or for a place in North Kolkata. So your basic intuition says that okay, you avail any vehicle that is northbound. That is your basic intuition. You always do that. Similarly, being at the central Kolkata, if you'd like to move to South Kolkata, and obviously you should have some vehicle which is southbound. That is your basic intuition, because it will provide you the guidance. Okay, if you follow that path, you may require minimum time, you may require minimum cost, I mean the minimum allowance that is needed, the fare, it will be minimum to reach at the destination. That is the basic idea. But you never know whether there is any obstacles in the path. There might be some obstacles. While you have started your journey from the central Kolkata, from Spanet to say North Kolkata, might be on the way some roads might be blocked because of some other events. You never know this thing. Once again, then you have to come back and you have to follow some alternate route to go there. So that must not be known always to you before you start the journey, before you do it, you start this action, you start scanning the nodes, or before you explore the nodes, the possibility of having the goal to be reached. However, this will provide us a rough estimation about which path to follow. Now, this best first search can also be visualized if I use it as an informed search. Then this best first search can also be used or can also be interpreted as a generalization of two of the uninformed search, as we have discussed already, that is best first search, breadth first search and uniform cost search. How is it so? So what I'm saying is, this best first search, which is a type of informed search, so this best first search can be regarded as a generalization. So I can consider this as a generalization of breadth first search and uniform cost search. The only thing that you need to keep in your mind is that for best first search, we always encounter or we always associate one evaluation function to each of the unexpanded nodes. Now let us consider the situation. What we have done in case of breadth first search. If you can remember properly, as we have discussed few hours back, for breadth first search, within the fringe, you need to expand that particular node which is having the minimum depth. For example, if I go back over here, suppose at any point of time, after we expand this B, you have E, F, G, and we have C and D. So within the fringe, you have these five nodes. E, you have F, you have G, you have C, you have D. So all these five nodes are there within the fringe or frontier. Now, as per as the rule of breadth first search is concerned, I think I have shown it for DFS anyway, the diagram being the same. So we have E, F, G, C, and D. So as far as the rule of BFS is concerned, the algorithm is concerned, after you produce this E, F, G, and then C and D are there already, after you explore B, your next job is to explore C. And next, you have to explore D. So while exploring C or before exploring C, you have E, F, G, C, and D. E, F, G, C, and D. In your fringe or frontier. Then out of these five nodes, you are going to expand C. Because C, or you can also expand D, but we are following this left convention, so that's why C first and then D. So why C or D? Because it is having a lower depth. It is at depth one, whereas E, F, G, they are at depth two. So therefore, breadth first search can also be regarded as a kind of best first search with the evaluation function equal to the depth of the node. So that is the tactics. Initially, people have come up with some arbitrary algorithms like DFS, BFS, and so on. And then they have understood the abstraction within the algorithm and they have come up with the generalization. Initially, we talk about some discrete kind of thing, some abstract kind of thing. But we cannot connect the abstraction together. There are certain abstractions which join each of the algorithms. But initially, when the algorithms are implemented or algorithms are developed by their own, then one cannot identify the connection between them. So that's why these DFS and BFS were initially introduced. But once the notion of DFS and BFS was readily available to the community, then the people can understand what is the difference between them and what are the advantages we are getting out of that. And then they have come up with some generalization, and the generalization is the best first search. So I can consider this best first search. This is equivalent to best first search. I can consider this is the best first search. With the evaluation, because since we are considering best first search, so obviously we need to associate some evaluation function with fn is equal to depth of n. So if I have, say, 5 number of such nodes in my frames or frontier, then I have to identify those nodes, those unexpanded nodes, for which the depth is the minimum. Now, if depth is minimum, then the fn value will be minimum. And if fn is minimum, that means the cost is minimum. And it will give us an estimate of desirability. So breadth first search can be regarded as a best first search with fn is equal to depth of n. Similarly, if I consider uniform cost search, in this particular case, it can also be regarded as a best first search with fn can be written like this. So what is fn here? This is nothing but sum of h costs. From the starting state to the state n. From start to n. So sum of h cost from start to n. And accordingly, the fn value has been determined. So if I just go back for this searching. So for every node, D, E, F, G, H, so for every node, one has to identify the corresponding evaluation function. If I want to observe this uniform cost search, as a special case of best first search. So what was done for each of these nodes, D, E, F, G, H, we need to identify the corresponding evaluation function. Now what I'm saying, the evaluation function is nothing but sum of the H cost from the start to the node N. So for D, what will be the evaluation function? It will be 2 plus 3. Because how to reach at D? A to B, B to D. So 2 plus 3, 5. How to reach at E? 2 plus 4, 6. How to reach at F? 3 plus 2, 5. So if I write down the evaluation function right over here, evaluation function for each of them, so I can write F of D is equal to 2 plus 3, 5. F of E, 2 plus 4, 6, F of F, 3 plus 2, 5, F of G, 3 plus 1, 4, and F of H, 3 plus 4, 7. So accordingly, within the fringe or within the frontier, we have to maintain a queue, a priority queue, and the node for which this f function, f value is minimum, that is selected for further expansion. This is the idea of uniform cost search, and we can readily identify that this uniform cost search can also be regarded as a special case of best first search. So after the introduction of the basic best first search, so best first search was basically the generalization of breadth first and depth first search to some extent, and uniform cost search. So now we can propose a greedy based first search for which the evaluation function is defined like this. The idea behind the best first search is that you have to assign one evaluation function to each of the node and select that particular node for which that function, a functional value is minimum. That will serve as a measure of desirability, estimate of desirability. So greedy best first search involves an evaluation function fn, sometimes it is also written like say hn, because fn is the property associated with the normal best first search. So one can write this as hn, which is nothing but the estimated cost from n to goal. That means what additional cost I need to pay to move from the node n to the node goal, to the goal node. Therefore it expands the node closest to the goal. So I don't know, suppose let me show you a state space. Suppose this is a starting node, and from each node different other nodes are generated, and accordingly I have to consider, suppose this is L and so on, this is M, N. So in this way the state space is expanded. Now within the fringe, suppose there are set of nodes, set of states available, and one has to identify that particular node. This algorithm will identify that particular node which is closest to the goal. That means if you can reach to that particular node by any means, then it will be easier for you to reach to the goal. Suppose the distance from G to the goal is say 5, and the distance from F to the goal is say 9, and the distance from E to the goal is say 7. So suppose these three nodes E, F and G, they are in the fringe, for example. Now if they are in the fringe, as you know, the distance is minimum for G. The distance between G and the goal is minimum, that is 5. Then we have E, for which the distance is 7, and then we have F, for which the distance is 9. Remember, G is not the distance from the starting node. G is the estimated cost from n to the goal. That means somehow if you reach at G, then you need to pay additional 5 units. However, if you reach to F, you have to pay additional 9 units. And if you reach to E, then you have to pay an additional 7 units. So based on that, the next node is selected for expansion. However, this greedy best first search is having some limitation, which I am going to explain now for this particular problem. Let us consider the most popular diagram, which is popularly employed for explaining any of these informed search algorithm. This is nothing but a city map of Romania. So we have different cities and the corresponding distance have also been mentioned over here. The distance from Zerin to Oradea is equal to 71, and the distance between Oradea and Cebu is 151. So this is nothing but the distance. So we have different cities connected like this. Not all the cities are connected together. So the connection is not exhaustive. Not all the cities are connected to each other. There are certain cities for which the connection is there, and otherwise we can easily find out what is the distance, the traveling distance from this city to that city. Now suppose, let us consider the situation. My idea or my objective is to move from this city Lasi to this Oradea. This is my starting state, and this is the goal state. Oradea is a goal state and Lasi is the starting state. So I start from this point and I would like to reach over here. Now while doing so, I have to follow this straight line because this is the only way I can go. So if you just look over here, so you have different possibilities. Either you go from this way, this way, this way, this way, then this way, this way, and this way. You can also go from this point, you can also go like this, or you can take a different route like this, this way, this way, this way. So there are different other possibilities. So one thing is very clear that you can reach the goal because these two are connected together. In fact, if you are at any city, since none of the city is isolated, they are connected to one or more cities by a road connection, by road. So if you are in one city, then obviously you will reach to some other city. There is no doubt about that. Now my objective is to go from this city, Lasi, to Oradea, this city. So this is my starting state. So from the starting state, I have to identify the cities which can be, which are closer to this starting state. Or rather, I can say, I have to, if this is the starting state, I have to identify the corresponding, or if this is the starting node, I have to identify the corresponding child node, children node. By taking an action from this city, what are the two cities where I can go directly? I cannot go from Lasi to Fagaras because I have to take several actions like this. So from one state to another state can be done. The transition from the one state to the other state can be done through a single operation. That means they have to be connected. So for this particular problem, so Lasi to Niam, the distance is 87 kilometers, for example. I don't know whether it is in kilometer or miles, but anyway, so since it is unitless, I can consider it will be kilometer or 87. So the distance is 87 here, so the cost is 87 from Lasi to Niam. And Lasi to Vaslui, the distance is 92. So from Lasi, you can go to two different cities, either Niam or Vaslui. Now, these are the two child node for this particular parent node. These are the two child node, Niam and Vaslui. What was the idea? Idea is to explore that particular city or that particular node which is closest to the goal. Now that can be done by using a heuristic function. As we have mentioned last time, the function was like h of n. So intentionally we have used the term hn to make sense that it is nothing but a heuristic function that can heuristically give you some information regarding what could have been the possible cost that you need to pay to reach to the goal from that particular node. So here, if I consider the heuristic function to be the simplest aerial distance from one city to the other city, and very soon we will prove that that particular notion is wrong. If my objective is to move from one city to the other city by road, then measuring the aerial distance will not help me anymore. We will prove it very quickly. Anyway, suppose let us assume that our objective is that we consider the HN to be the distance, straight line distance or aerial distance. From end to goal. So here we'll be talking about the distance, because our job is to move to that city, Oradea from Lassi. So straight line distance from end to goal will be the HN function, that is the heuristic function. Suppose I have defined the heuristic in that way. Then what happens? Now you can easily identify. If I just consider the coordinates of this particular city and this particular city, this is the distance. This will be the aerial distance. And on the other hand, there is another point, there is Vaslui. So this will be the distance, Oradea to Vaslui, this will be the distance. So it is quite apparent that this distance is minimum. I mean, if I compute h of n at Niam and h of m at Vaslui, this h of n will be minimum at Niam, considering the fact that Oradea is the final city to reach. That means this is the goal city, goal state. So out of these two, what you can select? You need to select Niam, because the distance is the minimum. If you go there, what happens? You have paid, so this is 87, for example. This is 87. So from Lassi to Niam, the cost becoming 87. And then from Niam, you don't have any other alternate. So this is not connected together. So that is the point. If these two cities are connected together, then obviously you don't have any problem. So you can directly go from this to 87 and then this to this. You can directly go by two hop. But this is not connected. So what happens? Once again, it will come back over here, because this is the, so only one possibility is there from Niam. So considering Lassi to be the parent state, so there could have been two different children state, like Niam and Vaslui. However, for Niam, once again, if Niam is the parent state, then once again from Niam, you can come back to Lassi. And once again, if you select Niam, because this seems to be convincing to you, because the aerial distance is minimum, I mean, the cost is minimum for it. So once again, the algorithm gets stuck into the loops. Lassi to Niam, Niam to Lassi. Lassi to Niam, Niam to Lassi, in this way. Because every time you calculate the distance, this h of n for Niam and Vaslui, because Lassi has only two options. Either it has to select either a Niam or Vaslui. But since the radial distance is less here, straight line distance, so therefore it will always select Niam. But Niam is not connected to any other cities apart from Lassi. So if it is connected to Vagaras or say Sibiu or say Zerind, if it is connected to any of the cities, then fine, we can have that path. But since it is not connected, it's a dead end. So once again, we'll go from lassi to niyam and niyam to lassi and niyam to lassi and lassi to niyam and so on and so forth. And you get stuck into loops. So this database search, it can get stuck into loops. What goes wrong actually? What goes wrong? Obviously, you have selected the heuristic function in such a way that it carries no meaning for the present scenario. Although we have considered this radial distance between Niyam and Oradea, or between any other cities from this city to that city, although we have calculated the straight line distance from end to goal being the heuristic function, but remember, it will give us wrong motion. Even for Niyam and Pythagoras, if you look over here, Niyam and Pythagoras, it might seem that these two are very close. This distance is very small as compared to any other, these other parts of Romania. However, if you would like to move from Niyam to Pythagoras, you cannot do it directly because there is no direct path. You have to go in, you have to follow this path, this Lassi, then Vaslui, then this, then obviously this in one half. So if I assume that aerial distance or straight line distance as my heuristic function, so there is a possibility that you can get stuck into loops. So this type of greedy based first search, although proves to be convincing in some scenario, but in some other cases, as I have shown in this particular example, which is a very popular example for greedy based first search, it seems that this is not complete. The search algorithm is not complete. Because even if the solution exists, obviously, from Lassi to Oradea, you can go directly by using some hops. Nobody can stop you. If you follow this path, this to this, this to this, and in this way, you can always go. So there are plenty of paths available to you. So if one selects, say, depth first search or breadth first search, so one can easily go there from Lassi. But if I follow this greedy-based first search algorithm, although in many cases you find it to be very useful, but this time it will misguide you. So what was the basic notion in informed search? The basic notion was that we get some guidance. In uninformed search, the entire searching process was done randomly. Depending upon the problem condition, the algorithm did not orient itself, orient its rules. It is having its own rule embedded into the memory, and accordingly, it will act. No matter what your algorithm, what your input is, what your problem requirement is. Breadth first search always searches the node, always scans the node breadthwise. Depth first search always scans the node depthwise. So far, so good. But to add some intelligence into it so that it cannot search randomly, so that it cannot do the same thing irrespective of the input condition, so people have thought, okay, let us add some information into it, so that it can find out the solution in quick succession. But however, we may not get this solution. And as a matter of fact, this greedy-based first search algorithm is known to be non-complete. So it is not at all complete. Sometimes for this particular example, we have seen that we are not, from lassi to niyam, if you follow this one, you cannot go directly. Then comes the time complexity. What could have been the possible time complexity for this greedy base first search? Now, if I follow the same condition that depth is m, you can always draw this entire thing, this entire graph, by means of the state space orientation, assuming that there are b is the maximum branching factor and m is the maximum depth of the search tree. So since there is no such guarantee and it heavily depends upon the heuristic function that you select, so it is quite possible that sometimes you have to exhaust all the nodes to finally come to the solution. And sometimes if your selection is good, if your selection about the heuristic function is good, then you can very easily go to the goal. You can easily find out the path. So that depends upon the heuristic function. So worst case, if I consider, you may have to explore all the nodes. So the time complexity could be as high as in the order of b to the power m. But we should make a note over here. However, a good heuristic function, this h function, a good heuristic function can provide a dramatic improvement. That is possible. So that depends. So instead of considering the straight line distance or radial distance, if you could take some other criteria during the formulation of the heuristic function, then there is a possibility that you might end up with a better time complexity. Similarly, for the space, you have to keep track about all the nodes which are present. That means all the city over here. So similarly, for the space complexity, it could have been as high as order of b to the power m. And since it is not complete, so one can easily say that it is not optimal as well, because it is not at all complete. So there is no guarantee that you will be getting the solution. So therefore, it is not at all optimal. Now, how to get rid of this problem? The problem associated with greedy base first search is that it can get stuck into loops. So to get rid of this problem, a new search technique has been proposed, and that is known as A-star search. What does it do? So there has been a slight modification. The idea is that avoid expanding that paths which are already expensive. So here, from lassi to niyam and niyam to lassi, so in this way, if you continue, then that path is becoming much more expensive. So if the algorithm goes by greedy base first search, then it must not take a decision why not to go to Vaslui, why not to take some other alternative to exploit the path. But since it blindly follows the algorithm of greedy base first, and which suggests that, okay, since the goal from Niyam to Oradea is minimum, I mean the straight line distance, Niyam to Oradea, since the distance is minimum, as far as the HN is concerned with respect to Vaslui, so always go by that. And that is the irony regarding this machine intelligence. We have trained the machine, but being a human being, if you find that, okay, if I follow this path many a times and I'm getting some obstacles every time, and since I am having another alternative at my hand, so being a human being, you always prefer to visit that particular city to reach at Oradea. But since you have trained the machine, the machine will do the same operations many times repeatedly without asking a question. He's such a fool. Anyway, so the idea regarding this A-star search is that we need to avoid expanding that path, which are already expensive. Which are already expensive. So for A-star search, the evaluation function is written like, so we need to consider two functions here, or two cost function. One is that particular function which have been considered for greedy best first search, that means what is the estimated cost of goal, I mean what is the estimated cost to reach to the goal from that particular aim. And the second function is, which we have already encountered, is what is the cost to reach at node number, at node n, from the starting state. So I can write this function as the estimated total cost of the path from start to goal through N. That is important. If N gives us a measure about the estimated total cost of the path. So since it obviously it is estimated, it should be estimated because we don't know what should be the exact value. So it will give you a kind of guidance. The guidance may be right sometimes, might be wrong sometimes, but we don't have an option. But we have to follow some guidance. Now, as you know, that is true in our real life also. Sometimes we do something without having any guidance from anyone else. We do based upon our own decision, our own maturity level, and we do some action. That might be right, might be wrong. And sometimes, even if I get some guidance from someone else who might be experienced enough, so there is no guarantee that if you strictly adhere to that particular guidance, you'll be getting a very good solution. It can be both way around. If you follow the guidance, then either you can get a very good solution, or you may end up with a terrible situation. Similarly, if you, one may argue that why to listen to that particular guidance, since it doesn't help me anyway. The point is that you have to take the guidance. You need to collect some information regarding the environment while making any decision, but don't do it blindly. you have to question each and every aspect of the guidance of this information. If you find that there is something wrong about that, you have to question it, and accordingly you have to rechange your mind setting and take decision accordingly. It's not that you always follow this particular guidance as was told by someone else every time in your life, and we generally not do this one. We don't do. We don't follow the same guidance from our childhood till our death. It's a function of time. It's a function of perspective, and it's a function of place, and so on and so forth. So therefore, you have to consider each of the attributes while formulating the this function, evaluation function. It talks about the total cost, estimated total cost, obviously, of the path from start to goal through the node N. For uniform cost search, only the path cost from the start to end was considered. We don't know anything about the future cost from end to goal. That means, suppose we have a structure like this. Now, while selecting any node, whether it is E or F or G, for uniform cost search, we have considered what is the path cost here. Here to here, 2. The here to here, 4. So total 6. Here to here, 5. 3. 5 plus 3, 8. 5 plus 4, 9. Just like this. So from start to the node N, what is the path cost, which I have already paid? And for greedy based first search, we have estimated something. Some cost that I have to pay to reach to the goal from this particular state or this particular node. So A star has combined each of these together, and accordingly, it writes this cost as a summation. I can also write simple summation, or if you wish, you can also write like a weighted summation. You can also assign some alpha gn plus beta hn kind of thing. So what is gn? Gn is the total cost so far. Total cost incurred so far, I should write. The total amount of cost that you need to pay incurred so far to reach N, to reach the node N from start. And what about HN? HN is the estimated total cost from N to the goal. So if I combine these two together, so Gn is the total cost incurred so far to reach at node N from the starting state, and HN is the estimated total cost from N to goal. So if I, so one cost is the total cost incurred, so it has been done already, and something, this cost, second cost is estimation. So something is estimation and something is already incurred. So if I combine these two together as a simple addition like gn plus hn, then it will give me the estimated total cost of the path from the start to the goal through n. And by virtue of this algorithm, let us have a look whether the previous problem of moving from one state to another state in the city of Romania can be sorted out or not. Let us come back to the same problem. I need to go from Lasi to Oradea. I'm having two different possibilities over here, Niam and Vaslui. Initially, I have to find out this h of n and g of n. So h of n is nothing but the estimated total cost from n to goal. And if I use it like a straight line distance, then for Niam, this h of n will be very small as compared to that of Vaslui, if I consider the aerial distance. However, this distance from Lasi to Niam and Lasi to Vaslui, as you find, it is 87 and 92. So here also, the gn is also small for Niam. So Niam is the obvious choice because gn is also small, and then the next, this distance is also small. So so Niam is the only choice. So then what happens? You go from Lasi to Niam. So when you reach to Niam, so what will be the fn value? If I assume that this distance, let me mark out over here. If I assume that this distance, for example, this distance is x. This distance is x from Niam to Oradea, and from Oradea to Vaslui, if I compute, this distance, suppose this is y, and obviously x is less than y. What I can do is I can make a copy of this slide. I can remove this one. So I'm considering the A-star search now. So here the idea is to calculate fn that is equal to gn plus hn . Now h of n is fixed because this is the estimated distance, estimated cost from Niam to Oradea or Vaslui to Oradea. So accordingly, Niam, considering Oradea to be the final state, this is x, and h of Vaslui, this will be y. And since x is less than y, so, and obviously you can also find out what is the value of gn. The gn value here is 87 for Niam and 92 for Vaslui. So if I add these two together, x plus 87 here and y plus 92 here, since x is less than y, so obvious choice is Niam. But after reaching Niam, you don't have any other option. This is the dead node. You don't have any other option to further expand it. The only one option is there to come back to Lasi. If you come back to Lasi and then You can find out what about the total cost. Then lastly, we'll expand these two together, Niyam and Vasudevi. Then if you go back to Niyam, then what is the total cost already incurred to reach to Niyam second time from the Lassi? Initially from Lassi to Niyam already 87, and then another 87. And then another 87, because you have to come back over here also. So Lassi to Niyam 87, Niyam to Lassi 87. So now if you want to take a decision for the second time, already the cost incurred is equal to 87 into 2. And you have to pay additional 87 and X here to find out Fn. And on the other hand, for Vasudevi, this Y is constant and the additional value is 92 only. So now you have to compare between 87 into 3 plus X, 87 into 3 plus X with 92 plus Y. And then after one or two iteration, there is a high chance, and it can be proved, that after one or two iteration, if X and Y are almost comparable, if not that much difference is there between X and Y, suppose X equal to 200 and Y is equal to 300 or so, the comparable range X and Y, then after two or three iteration, this A star algorithm will select Vasudevi as the node to be expanded, because the eigenvalue is remaining constant for both Niyam and Vasudevi. This is X and Y, but the GN value, which is the cost so far to reach at N from the starting state. So initially, if I go from this point, 187. And then you have to come back. So 87 plus 87. And then another 87. So if one has to reach Niyam for the second time from Lassi, so the total cost incurred already is 87 into 3. Plus you have this H of N value. And one point will come when this, I may consider like this, 2m plus 1 point will come when 2m plus 1 into 87 plus x will be greater than 92 plus y. If you consider the second iteration, for the first iteration will be 87 plus x, so it is always less than 92 plus y. That is fine for the first iteration when m equal to 0. Or you can also write like, if I would like to make it simpler, then instead of writing 2m plus 1, I can write it like 2m minus 1. So for m is equal to 1, obvious choice is this one will be lower as compared to this one, so Niyam will be selected. For m equal to 2, we have 3 into 87 plus x. That might also be comparable or less than 92 plus y. But a point will come. So here it will happen at mth iteration when this 2m minus 1 and 87 plus x will be higher than 92 plus y. This will happen at mth iteration. So at mth iteration, Vasudevi will be selected, or Vasudevi will be expanded instead of Niyam. And that is the success of this STAR search algorithm. So it avoids expanding those paths which are already expensive. If we do not incorporate the notion of GN into the discussion or into the deliberation, then obviously, from Lassie to Niyam and Niyam to Lassie, this continuous movement will be going on, and the algorithm will stuck into the loops, and it cannot move to the solution or goal. So this is all about some of the informed search algorithm, which I have tried to touch upon in this particular lecture. And with this, let me conclude this discussion on informed search algorithms.